This video is sponsored by Silverstone. The innovative Ice Mist all-in-one cooler allows you to stack RGB fans on the water block, which can easily direct airflow to any hotspots on the motherboard, VRMs, or DRAM. Pick up the Ice Mist AIO today and equip your PC with this unique high-performance cooler.
Hey PC World fans, Adam here at CES 2024 with arguably the most important person on the show floor. We got Paul from Paul's Hardware.
You're too kind.
Thank you for joining me. You know, we've seen some announcements, obviously nothing groundbreaking from the big companies, but there has been some nice solid mainstream announcements from NVIDIA and Intel and AMD. And so I feel like all the major shakeups are probably not gonna happen again for maybe till Computex time. Yeah, yeah. So like the first half of the year, if you're building a PC, I just wanna kind of assess things now. Right. Let's kind of start off on the low end, because obviously AMD now has AM5 based APUs. Are you excited about having AM5 based APUs?
I am excited about having AM5 based APUs. I'm not excited about the naming scheme. I don't like to get too hung up on stuff. I just hate when it seems like they're trying to be tricky. Anytime it seems like they're, you know, and it's not aimed at us. It's not aimed at people who, you know, have their heads in the industry and who are always following, you know, all the launches and have a, like, I do that and I still can't list all the CPUs in the stack that's available right now. But for people who are coming to it, having not built a computer or bought a computer in years, and they're just looking at the numbers. And they just look at what's the higher number.
So eight's bigger than seven, so it's got to be better, right?
So it's frustrating when someone might make a decision based on that. And it's not the first time they've done this, but like might buy an 8000 series APU, even though they're getting like a discrete graphics card, simply because they think it's going to be a faster processor. And I just don't like it. I wish they named it a little bit more in line with the 7000 series, which, because it's the same architecture, it's the same platform.
Yeah.
And then I could ignore complaining about all that, and I could be like, APUs. I like APUs. It's a great starting out point for someone building a system. The integrated graphics for 7000 series are really just there for a display out for the chips that have been launched so far. So I'm excited to see what the performance is like for the integrated graphics that they have there. AMD has traditionally done a pretty good job with that. And I think it would be a good thing to recommend for first-time builders who are looking to spend probably in the $500-ish range for a build, $500 to $600. And then hopefully they'll also perform well when paired with the discrete graphics card to, you know, give people that upgrade path in the future.
Well, interesting enough, AM4 also still doesn't die.
I know.
They released four new AM4 based chips, which, I mean, that's a good entry level point too. What's your thoughts of somebody to get like maybe a 5700 X3D rather than a 8700G?
I mean,
obviously the 5700 X3D, you need a discrete graphics card, but I'm just saying like, you know, should you build into AM4 with these really good prices, you got the stability, or would you rather be like, you know what, save your money up for a bigger GPU and go AM5 right now?
Well, I always like when there are more choices, as long as it's not too insanely confusing. But I also like when you have a difficult choice. It's like, well, you're gonna save money on AM4. You're gonna be able to buy cheaper motherboards. You're gonna be able to go with DDR4 memory, which at least for now is still readily available and inexpensive.
Yeah, yeah.
You're not gonna be getting yourself that upgrade path unless you're talking about like the 5800 X3D, but I mean, there's probably not gonna be too many people upgrading in that way. So it's a trade-off, but again, I think for anyone who's looking entry level, for anyone who's looking to like get into PC gaming and all the other stuff you can do with the PC and not spend $1,000, $1,200, $2,000, it's probably gonna be a very viable option. And another thing I'll say about AM4, the longevity of the platform, it's tried and true. Like, there's not a whole lot
of
question marks
So. And there's still a lot of coverage out there too, right? Of like, hey, you it's a known quantity.
Yeah.
So, and it's still a little early days. I mean, even though these new APUs are based on the same architecture, you know, it's still a little newer for the platform. And
So I've heard a few people say that it's like a soft CES this year, because there haven't been any of those major announcements, any of the big breakthroughs. They want to convince us that it's AI. And granted, AI is, there's stuff to talk about there.
Yeah, we'll talk about it in another video for sure.
There's discussions to be had. But apart from the AI nebulous thing, like, there isn't anything massive, but I've considered it more of a foundational Like, you're not getting the top tier stuff, but they're filling in the foundation of what's available there.
More mainstream, right?
You know, the four GPUs that are announced, the three from NVIDIA and AMD's RX 60.
7600 XT
with 16 gigs. I mean, I think that's a unique and interesting card, and it's not crazy expensive. So
yeah. Well, and it definitely feeds that next price range up. So around the, you know, $1,000 kind of thing, like, you've got that. Arc is still around, you know, and definitely has seen some improvements. I think with the new super cards, it's going to shift things a little bit, you know, until maybe non-super variants dry up kind of stuff. So, like, we're seeing shakeups there, and I feel like at that price range at $1,000, like, you could still build a really good machine. Like, do you agree with that? Or
I do, and, like, whenever I try to put it into words, my feelings about it, it's split in half. There are two halves, because take, for example, NVIDIA's decision to make the RTX 4080 Super $1,000. On one hand, I am somewhat pleasantly surprised by that, based on NVIDIA's track record. On the other hand, we're also, like, you know, an abused victim who is like, oh, thank you for not smacking me with the billy club again or something like that. I mean, obviously I'm exaggerating, but you know, it's like, well, at least they're not sucking as much as they could have. And, you know, the other cards that are coming in, they should fill in the gaps there at their price points. And they're not going to be, like, crazy deals or anything. But I am glad, asterisk, that the 4080 Super is $1,000 and not $1,200 or $1,400.
Right.
I actually didn't see that coming.
Yeah, no, I didn't expect that either. But, yeah, so, I mean, I do think at that price range, though, I mean, me personally, obviously I'm in this position, so, you know, we're kind of in a different spot. Mm. Like, that's kind of the price range I would probably target.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, for if I had my own personal build, it's like that $1,000. And I feel like, oh, man, we can get some good stuff. Well, stepping up to the extreme stuff, I think that's where we haven't seen anything new, right? Mm. You know, some people were hoping for a 4090 Super, 4090 Ti, or RTX or whatever, who knows, you know. And then
it's like, I bet they have one.
Like, I'm not sure.
You know they could.
Yeah.
They're just like, what's the point? We're fine with the 4090s. Let's take those, you know, the silicon output that we currently have booked with the fabs and make more AI chips.
Yeah.
It's probably what they're doing. But if they were only doing that, though, I feel like we would see more scarcity, or expected scarcity, with, like, the 4080 Super, and we probably would see them targeting a higher price because they're going to have fewer of them available. So I was pretty pessimistic last year about the progress of NVIDIA with AI. I mean, granted, if you're into AI, they're making leaps and bounds there, but I was seeing it as reflected in the PC hardware space, and kind of concerned that, like, as we went through the GPU shortage, you know, of a few years back, like, that it was going to be that same situation. They were going to be scarce, difficult to find if you wanted anything high-end. It doesn't seem like we're quite there yet.
Yeah.
And it does seem like they're at least trying to balance things out somewhat to make sure that there's inventory available, so we're not just going to see shortage situations again with prices suddenly spiking way over MSRP.
Yeah. Well, but I feel like at the super high end, it's not as much about the main core components like CPU and GPU, things like that. Mm-hmm. Like, I feel like now we're getting more options than ever for, like, high range builds, like the Lian Leo 11 Vision, right? You know, like these cases that are, like, real super premium, or the height with, like, the touchscreen and things like that. And, like, a lot of people are getting into, like just building, like, really high end showcase kind of builds around that stuff, rather than being like, oh, okay, well, I got 1400K and a 4090. What else do I do?
Well, the manufacturers will always look for something to create to lure in people to spend a little bit more money. Mm. And, you know, you gotta, that's what they do. They're manufacturers, they're making stuff to sell. As long as, again, it doesn't seem like they're trying to go too out of their way to create something out of nothing. That was kind of my initial impression of the back-to-front stuff, the connectors on the back of the motherboard, which I've been
skeptical. Yeah, because we talked about a Computex, and you were like, no, I don't think so.
I just want intercompatibility, so all the manufacturers I've been talking to, and I don't know how much pull I have with them, I'm saying, you guys just get together. We've seen them do it before.
Right?
They've agreed on standards before. We need a supplemental ATX standard four connectors on the back, and all it is cutouts. It's just decide where those cutouts are going to be, and then they can make motherboards that meet those standards, and you can get an ASUS motherboard in whatever case you want that's, you know, fits the spec, or Gigabyte, or, you know,
well,
MSI, whatever.
I don't know if you've seen, like, over at Cooler Master, they have a case that adopts all three standards. Mm-hmm. We were just over at Corsair. They have a case that adopts the Project Zero and the BTF.
Okay.
And they said they're trying to get the Gigabyte One as well. So right now, it's kind of like some case manufacturers are like, well, we'll just be safe and kind of have extra room around everything. But like, there is that consideration of like, all right, you're punching more holes in there. What about rigidity, mm-hmm. kind of thing? So yeah, we need to sit down. You're right. We need to sit down and be like, hey, you know what? We can work together. We're a big family. Mm-hmm. We'll figure it out. It's not that far off, though.
Yeah.
Like, it's more like everyone's got little subtle variations of where things are placed. That I think they can be solved. I think it.
And I've also come around a little bit more in terms, because for me it's all about practicality, ease of use, functionality,
oh, yeah.
and especially for new builders. Like we want more people to experience the joy of building their own PC,
getting
it up and running. And I will say that for a new builder, having those connectors on the back, I think, can ease things up in terms of plugging certain things in, especially like your supplemental 8-pin CPU connectors. They're all always tucked up in the corner and difficult to reach if you have a radiator or something
right.
like that. So,
I mean, I actually got to build in the Project Zero before the okay. holidays, and I was already on board kind of thing. And then when I built in it, I mean, I've built plenty of PCs, but so it was just like a time-saving thing. I was like, oh, boom, 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 boom. But yeah, I can imagine for a first-time builder, you know, maybe they just lay their case down or whatever, and it's like, okay, the motherboard's in, I got the power supply in, boom, 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 boom. You don't
There's
have to do
plugs.
That dance of like, yeah. oh, which hole do I go through? But also, one of the vendors, I probably can't name, one of them was saying, hey, now that the connectors are on the backside, mm-hmm. Then you don't need to worry about aesthetics in a certain way.
Okay.
That what if the power supply cable was coated for the actual port. So, you know,
okay.
the 24 pin is, the port is red and the cable's red, so you know when to plug it in, which would look ugly if it was on the front, but since it's on the back and nobody sees it, that's another ease of use thing of like, oh, you know, you know exactly where those cables go.
And I would completely agree with that. Like, I'd be behind that, because again, it's functional, it's useful, it helps bring new people into the space. So
yeah.
that sounds, I'm on board with that.
Well,
the other side of it for me is the ASUS graphics cards with the edge connector, because that
yeah.
breaks compatibility with the motherboard. And so those, I'm like, I know ASUS is bringing them to market. They've got a 4070 and a 4090. It's going to happen, and there are people who are going to buy them. That's okay. I'm just saying, trying to stick to my principles. I'm not as enthusiastic
about
that.
Might be a bit too far.
Yeah.
Is that what you're saying?
And I mean, what about the sleeve cable guys? What about, what
yeah.
have we thought
Don't
about
put them?
Them?
Out of work.
Have we considered
yeah.
how nice a nice trained, sleeved,
yeah.
you know, properly combed set of cables can look.
It's
like,
a skill, it's a skill.
There's
yeah.
nothing wrong with that.
Well,
so.
And actually, the Project Stealth version, where they actually put the power connector from this side to this side,
mm.
so it's that same kind of deal where you just access it from the back.
Yeah.
You know, I've poked around, some people have said, it's not really, you know, the power delivery is not really made for that kind of thing, but I feel like that's like a good in-between, where it's
yeah.
not proprietary, but mm. you also still don't have to see the cable out front either.
That's
so,
true.
I don't know. But
so
what do I know? I'm not an engineer.
It's like a whole range of additional options for people,
yeah,
which,
yeah.
again, I'm cool with, as long as choosing that option doesn't suddenly mean you're blocked out of like this whole other set of stuff that you might have
yeah.
for potential upgrades. Selling a graphics card in the future, something like that, the secondary market, things should be reused as long as they're functional. And try to sell a graphics card, well, you better make sure the person you're selling it to has a motherboard with that edge connector, if that's
right.
the GPU you have. So.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and I think, I mean, it starts with the cases,
mm-hmm.
right? Because you can buy the case, even if it has the cutout zones, you don't have to use them. You
yeah.
can still use whatever motherboard you want. So I think a lot of cases, you know, will just have that and have it be an option. Then some people are like, no, I like the traditional style. And then some are like, oh, no, I will take advantage of the fact that this case has this kind of thing. So
maintaining flexibility. And to circle back to what it's kind of what we were starting to talk about, like, that's, I think, the thing I've appreciated the most when it comes to the launches. I think the AMD CPU announcements, Intel fleshing out the rest of their 14th gen lineup
yeah.
as well with the lower end models that you know, people might be interested in as well. Having those options that are more budget oriented for people who are trying to build a system and stick to a budget and not having to spend upwards of $1,000. Yeah. There are now more choices, and the choices are more powerful than they were last year. So.
And also, in some ways, I feel like we're going to like specificity. I'm tired. Where it's just like, hey, you know, there's CPUs that are like, hey, you know what, X3D parts, good for gaming, right? Mm. You know, and then there's like, oh, high core count, you know, and then there's like disaggregated architecture kind of stuff. So I feel like we're almost going down a lane too, where it's like certain components are like specialized, right? You know, so it's more options.
And and on the, I don't know, what's better? What do you guys think? Is it better to be able to choose this, I want to get this CPU because I'm building a gaming PC, I might do some other stuff. Well, I want to choose this CPU because I'm going to do a bunch of video rendering or whatever, I need a lot of cores.
Yeah.
To have the choose between those, or would it be better if there's just one, like, the god CPU that's the best at everything, which I don't think exists at this point.
Yeah.
But
well, in the past, I mean, it was just simple. It's like, oh, okay, well, the more you pay, the more you get, right? Like, oh, you want the best performing one? Then buy the most expensive one, right? Now it's like, oh, no, well, that's not necessarily the case because the 7800 X3D at half the price of a 1400K can actually hang and in some ways, like, beat it, you know? So it's like, oh, okay, well, it's not as easy as just buy the most expensive thing anymore. So it's interesting times. Exciting times, I should say.
We're getting a little spoiled for choice, I think, at this point.
I like it. But it does sound like Computex is going to have some big stuff, too. So I think, you know, if you wait, if you're like, oh, you know what, I can wait a little bit, maybe Computex is it's going to blow some doors off. So
should be exciting.
At least cross your fingers anyway.
How many, like, of all the vendors you went to, how many of them had at least something that they're like, we can't show this yet, but Computex.
Yes.
It's they're excited about the
very
stuff
high
that's
number.
Not quite ready, but it's still
very
in the
high
works,
number.
So.
From components to, you know,
lots of stuff.
all the vendors.
Just trail off there. And, like, those things.
Fun stuff. So anyway, thank you for chatting with me about this,
well.
Paul. I got to say, if you don't know, I mean, I think people know, but Paul does some awesome build guides lately over on your channel.
Thank
so
you.
If you're looking at specific price points or if you're looking to just know like what you recommend, that's the place to be, Pulse Hardware.
My 2023 guide is still totally viable, and I will be making a new one for 2024 as well.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Paul.
And thank you
for watching. Subscribe, Pulse Hardware. Subscribe here on PC World.
We'll catch
you in the next video.